Well, an unthinkable disaster. Two massive skywalks crush hundreds of revelers.
You don't walk into a multi-million dollar hotel with any thought in your mind that the thing is going to collapse on you.
I knew the people around me were dead.
The city springs into action.
There were people that worked beyond their endurance and are unsung heroes.
And I'm most proud of a community that was considered a classic response.
Confusion.
My priorities were rearranged that day.
So we watched.
15 seconds.
It will never leave my mind.
Tonight on Minute by Minute, the 1981 Hyatt Hotel collapse. July 17th, 1981, Kansas City, Missouri, 5 p.m. The city is buzzing with activity as thousands make their way out into the hot, muggy evening, the work week fast becoming a memory. In West Kansas City, 30-year-old real estate appraiser Tom Weir and his wife, Jean, plan to spend the weekend out of town. But first, they're heading down to the weekly tea dance at the city's new Hyatt Regency Hotel. Since they began in May, the hotel's tea dances are the place to be on a Friday night.
We decided before we got packed that we wanted to go to one of the dances. We were going to meet another couple, Charlie and Jane Hayes.
Across town, the Hayeses are getting ready for their night out. Chuck is a WHP radio news reporter, and Jane works for the city.
We really weren't into the music, but it was a class place to go.
The Hyatt's 40-story tower, complete with a revolving restaurant at the top, makes it one of the city's tallest buildings. 34-year-old Mark Williams plans to meet a friend there before going to dinner.
A friend of mine said, I want to check it out. And I said, fine, I'll meet you for a drink.
250 miles away in St. Louis, 52-year-old Jack Gillum, the structural engineer of the Kansas City Hyatt, is on his way home.
I had returned home in Kansas City because I was over there on a business trip. And in fact, I was with one of the architects on Hyatt at that time.
Gillum's engineering firm has been busy with new contracts in Kansas City ever since the grand opening of the Hyatt a year before. Since then, the Hyatt has become one of the city's most popular hotels. But Gillum doesn't know that a construction flaw has made its lobby as dangerous as a time bomb. KNBC-TV news reporter Michael Mahoney and his cameraman arrive at the Hyatt to cover the tea dance for an upcoming broadcast.
These tea dances had become a weekend phenomenon of Kansas City. The night of July 17th, there were well over 1,000 people in there.
Spanning the spectacular four-story atrium lobby are three steel and concrete bridges, or skywalks, which are supported by 1 1/4-inch suspension rods.
When you looked up, you saw these three very impressive skywalks up there, and you kind of went, this is a cool place.
Facing east toward the main entrance, the second floor skywalk looks as if it's floating above the lobby floor. But its looks are deceiving. The hanger rods supporting all three of the walkways strain to carry their 32-ton weight. One of those support rods on the fourth floor skywalk is stressed nearly to its breaking point. At nearby Baptist Medical Center, 35-year-old emergency medicine specialist Dr. Joe Wackerly has finished his 12-hour shift, but his day is not quite over.
The hospital that I work at has 11 floors, so that I could run the stairs to get in shape for the upcoming rugby season. After work, my partner came in to assume duties, and I started running the stairs.
A few miles away, in Midtown, Mayor Richard Berkeley and his wife greet guests arriving at their home for a party. Mayor Berkeley realizes that a guest's car is blocking his own.
I said to our police officer, Bill Aguirre, I said, Bill, we've got to move that. You just never know when you're going to have to use the car.
Across town, 23-year-old ambulance driver Patty Robinson is having an easy start to the evening.
We work 24-hour shifts based out of a fire station, and it had been extremely quiet that day.
At her home a mile away, off-duty paramedic Peggy Lohman, the mother of three, is attempting a rescue of a different sort.
that particular day, our cat had gotten out and run off, and it was also my daughter's, my middle child's birthday, and we were out in the car looking for the cat.
Mark Williams arrives and makes a loop around the atrium lobby, looking for his friend.
I rode the escalator up, walked across the skywalks, came back down.
Chuck Hayes and his wife, Jane, drop their car keys with the valet and walk into the hotel.
They had several standing bars around the lobby. We walked back to the one of the bars, got a couple drinks, and then walked back to the southwest corner of the building where we met Jim and Jane, two of our friends.
The Hayeses can't find their other friends, Tom and Jean Weir, so they make their way slowly through the crowd to one of the lobby's four bars. The Weirs arrive 20 minutes late. They split up to look for Chuck and Jane Hayes.
When we came into the hotel, it was literally wall-to-wall people. So I said, well, why don't you look around and see if you can find everyone? And in the meantime, I'll get some drinks.
As Tom Weir waits in line at one of the bars, 11-year-old Dalton Grant arrives with his family.
My parents wanted to go to it, so they dragged the kids along. I didn't want to be there to begin with. I'm an 11-year-old kid. It's an early summer evening, and I'm going to put on my church clothes and go down to some dance.
Dalton heads off with his mother, Connie, toward the main bar to get drinks. KNBC reporter Michael Mahoney and his cameraman take the escalator up to the second floor restaurant.
We need to get up and away from the crowd and the band and the noise a little bit.
Once there, they stop taping to change a battery.
He was in the process of changing the tape. I was in the bag groveling for a battery for him.
I remember standing there with my arms crossed to get a drink.
We kept edging closer and closer to the dance floor because I wanted to see what was going on.
I saw Jean after I picked up our drinks, and I was following along behind her.
We just started walking toward the band.
Suddenly, guests standing on the fourth floor skywalk lose their footing when a suspension rod rips through its connection.
I heard a real sharp metallic pop.
The 117-foot walkway comes crashing down, pancaking onto the second-floor skywalk.
There were people that were grabbing onto the side of the brass rails, trying to hang on as they were going down.
Both skywalks fall, raining 64 tons of steel, concrete, and glass onto the hundreds of people below.
It was pitch black, and it was just excruciating pain. My first thought was that the entire hotel had collapsed.
It was like been hit by a freight train.
My knees were by my ears. I was asking, is this a dream? I just kept going, is this a dream? Is this a dream?
After the crash, there was just an eerie calm. There were no screams, no nothing. And it seemed like for an eternity. One by one, you could hear the cries for help.
At Kansas City's newest hotel, July 17th, 1981, Kansas City, 7:06 p.m. At the Hyatt Regency Hotel, two massive steel and concrete skywalks have just collapsed onto hundreds of people enjoying the hotel's tea dance. The area just inside the main entrance is now a mountain of smoking rubble. The collapse has broken a water main, and the lobby is slowly filling up with water. No one knows how many are dead, or how many more cling desperately to life, buried beneath the debris. Tom Weir and his wife, Jean, were standing directly below the second floor walkway when it came crashing down. Somehow, Tom is conscious, though in excruciating pain.
My left leg was up across my chest, next to my head. My head was sideways on the floor, and I never hurt so much in my life.
Weir has no idea where his wife, Jean, is, or if his friends, Chuck and Jane Hayes, are safe. 11-year-old Dalton Grant is buried nearby with a broken pelvis. His mother, Connie, is a few inches away with two broken ankles.
She was just up and to the right of me. I could touch her leg. My mom, luckily, was an emergency room nurse. She said, don't go to sleep. You go into a coma when you're in that severe shock.
Radio newsman Chuck Hayes is pinned from the waist down at the lobby's south end, staring up at a section of the fourth floor bridge that is propped at a dangerous angle. His legs are shattered, and he has 6 compression fractures in his spine.
I can remember lying there, looking around me in this gray water, and the water turned from gray to a murky red, which was blood.
His wife, Jane, is close by. Though her body is almost completely crushed, she is still alive. At the north end of the lobby, Mark Williams has managed to survive in a space the size of a suitcase.
My right leg was across my chest and behind my left ear. My left leg was out of the socket and back up across my back and behind my right ear.
5 minutes after the collapse, dozens of 911 calls go out to the police and fire departments.
The balcony collapsed. There may be 50 to 100 people. Oh, Jesus.
Come to the Hyatt Regency immediately. 3 sky bridges fell in.
3 what?
Sky bridges holding people from the third floor fell and crashed.
Kansas City Fire Department Deputy Chief Arnett Williams is in his office at station number 10 when a call comes in from his dispatcher.
The terminology was that there had been some kind of collapse at the Hyatt Regency Hotel. I couldn't fathom that this would ever happen. This is the newest structure, I think, in Kansas City at that particular time, one of the most modern.
Williams sends 4 pumpers and 2 truck companies in response. Other emergency personnel race to the scene.
The call came in. And it came in for, I believe, a structural collapse. Had no idea what we were going into.
Eight miles from the Hyatt, Dr. Joe Wackerly walks into the emergency department, exhausted after exercising for an hour. He is about to go home when a nurse stops him.
The nurse said to me, you have a call from the ambulance dispatch people. And I said, what do they need? I'm not on duty. And she said, I don't know. So I got on the phone and they said, the roof is caved in and there's some people hurt.
Wackerly throws on scrubs over his workout clothes and races to the hotel. Kansas City Mayor Richard Berkeley is holding a reception at his home when he receives a phone call informing him of the disaster. He and his driver jump in his car.
We dashed out. I don't think I met a single guest that night, though a couple of them might have arrived by the time I left, immediately went down to the hotel.
250 miles away, in St. Louis, the man who helped design the Hyatt, 52-year-old structural engineer Jack Gillum, returns home from dinner to a ringing phone. It is a business associate of his.
I picked it up, and he says, Jack, there's been a collapse at the Hyatt. I just was dumbfounded. I mean, it was just like something hitting you in as hard as it can in your stomach.
Gillum immediately charters a plane to the scene. In the hotel's lobby, hundreds of gallons of water from the ruptured sprinkler system are still pooling on the floor.
After I walked in, I noticed there was a lot of water. I looked and it was red water. You know. And I'm assuming that this is a covered carpet, but after further examination, I found out that this was blood.
Deputy Chief Williams sets up a command post outside the main entrance. He orders his men to cut off the water and the electricity, but this will take precious time. Many victims trapped beneath the debris are in danger of drowning.
The debris was right here, so I couldn't really lift my head. There was one circle of light that was coming into where I was, and the water kept rising and shutting off that light and that air.
What I would do was suck in a mouthful of water, try to raise my head, spit it out, get a breath of air, and then put my head back down again.
The water is coming up to where I'm starting to breathe it in my nose, and I kept thinking to myself, well, if this is the way I gotta go, I've read this isn't too bad.
Twenty minutes after the collapse, Dr. Joe Wackerly arrives on the scene to find the dazed and wounded streaming out of the hotel. After setting up a makeshift triage unit on the Hyatt's front lawn with two fellow doctors, he assumes leadership of the medical care inside the hotel.
You really have to collect your presence for a moment. Take what resources are currently available and give those to the people that we think have the best chance of survival. And the other people, we have to basically say, you need to make your peace with your God, because there's nothing I can do right now.
Kansas City Fire Department media liaison Joe Galletti arrives.
I could see all these bodies protruding from the edges of the skywalks. And it was a shock. It was a real shock. People were screaming, people were running, panicked.
Emergency workers try their best to do their jobs amidst the carnage.
It was hot summertime, very hot, and people were screaming and crying for air. I can't breathe, I can't breathe. It was just terrible.
There was a man just inside the lobby. He was trapped under some debris, and I felt like somebody was looking at me. And so I made eye contact with him, and it was like, you know, he was really dead.
You always have that moment when you say, am I really ready for this? Am I trained for this? Am I going to do a good job? Oh, please let me do a good job.
40 minutes after the collapse, dozens of victims are still inside, trapped or buried beneath the rubble.
I knew the people around me were dead. I mean, I knew instantly. I won't go into how I knew, but it was, I knew.
People were hurt badly. They were screaming, they were crying, they were moaning.
You start to figure it out that the chances aren't good.
Underneath a precariously balanced wedge of concrete on the lobby's south side, Chuck Hayes tries to speak to his severely injured wife, Jane.
I said, are you there? And she said, yes, I am. I'm hurt. And I said, I know you are, sweetheart. I know you're hurt bad. But hang on. Help will be here. And I said, I love you.
Jane slips into unconsciousness. She and all of the victims need help fast, but they must fight to stay alive while firefighters formulate an unorthodox rescue plan. July 17th, 1981, Kansas City. Hyatt Regency Hotel, 7:50 p.m. It's been 45 minutes since two skywalks collapsed on hundreds of partygoers. More than 30 people are confirmed dead, over 100 injured. Firefighters open the front doors, forcing the water from a ruptured pipe out of the hotel's main entrance. On the south side of the lobby, under a section of skywalk that's propped dangerously against a wall, Chuck Hayes is trapped from the waist down.
I can remember one of the firemen saying, this thing's gonna go and it's gonna crush everybody under here. So you say a quiet prayer, you prepare yourself to die.
Construction workers arrive on the scene with jackhammers and concrete saws. They begin cutting up the 64 tons of rubble in the hope that the smaller sections can be hoisted up. It is no use. The fire department's jacks cannot budge the huge slabs of concrete. Chuck Hayes can only wait and hope that rescuers find a way to free him and his wife, Jane, who is unconscious and pinned a few feet away.
I had to know that she was out and safe. I can remember the feeling of such helplessness.
Hayes' friend, real estate appraiser Tom Weir, is buried near the center of the collapse and tries in vain to locate his wife, Jean.
I started calling out her name and heard no response.
Just a few yards from Weir, 11-year-old Dalton Grant is trapped beside his mother, Connie. All of the victims buried alive cling desperately to the sound of each other's voices, but even whispering wastes precious air.
I couldn't talk that much underneath there to save oxygen. We were praying underneath there, and I just kept asking, are we gonna die? And she's like, if we do, it's gonna be much better than here. Just stay with me.
Buried deep underneath the north end of the fallen skywalks, 34-year-old Mark Williams speaks to a little girl trapped nearby.
I asked her name and how she was doing. She said, well, I hurt pretty bad. And I said, well, I heard you saying your prayers. And I said, does that make you feel better? And she said, yeah. And I said, well, would you like me to say some prayers with you? And she said, I'd like that.
As Williams and the girl pray, heavy jacks, normally used for lifting houses, are brought in. Rescuers manage to raise the skywalk, pinning Chuck Hayes' shattered legs just enough to pull him and his wife to safety.
When I was pulled out, my hands had constricted around a man's shoe. That shoe had to be pried out of my hands. And in that shoe was a foot and an ankle. And those are things you never ever forget.
Hayes' wife, Jane, is almost totally crushed. She is given last rites at the scene before paramedics rush the couple to St. Mary's Hospital. Kansas City's Natural Disaster Response Team, known as Operation Bulldozer, arrives on the scene with front-end loaders and other heavy equipment. But Fire Department Deputy Chief Arnett Williams quickly realizes that Operation Bulldozer will be no help in this situation. If anyone is still alive in the wreckage, heavier lifting tools will be needed.
My first thought was we don't need earth-moving equipment. We could get cranes over, and we could put the cranes down through the top of the skylights on top of the atrium and the skylights there, that we could lift these massive slabs of concrete off of the victims.
Williams calls construction cranes to the scene. Before sending the bulldozers away, he orders them to rip out the lobby's front door frame to allow easier access to the site. Inside the lobby, twisted under the center of the downed skywalks, his left leg crushed, Tom Weir is losing hope. Since the collapse, Weir has been trying to get a response from his wife, Jean, through the darkness. He has lost count of the number of times he has called out to her. Suddenly,
I heard her voice say, Tom Weir. And at that point, that was all that mattered. I think that probably was one of the saving graces of willingness on my part to do whatever I could to stay alive, because she was alive.
It is just over 3 hours after the collapse. With most of the injured already transferred to area hospitals, a sense of futility has descended on the rescue effort. Firefighter Mark Graven passes what was once the lobby's main bar. He yells down into the debris, hoping to hear a response.
I was walking across the top of the skywalks, and I heard this mumbling of, help, help. And a man with a jackhammer came over and started jackhammering. So I got on my hands and knees and just started cleaning the hole.
KMBC TV reporter Michael Mahoney has returned to his studio and reports the breaking story to viewers across the country on the ABC News program Nightline.
And it came down in the middle, Ted, and people began to slide off, they began to jump out, and instantaneously these huge iron beams that support it fell down on the hundreds of people below.
In television, there's an old saying that you lead with your best pictures. Well, the best pictures here, unfortunately, were terrible pictures. They were chaos, they were death, and they were destruction.
And people simply could not believe that such a beautiful hotel had been devastated in such a way by this terrible, terrible accident tonight.
News reports during the program request blood donations, and Kansas City responds.
Everyone knew that they had an enormous problem, and everyone tried to help in every way that they could. It was just a community spirit.
Firefighter Mark Graven finally squeezes his torso down through the debris and finds several victims, including Tom and Jean Weir.
They called down and said, is anyone down here? And a number of us called up. So I said, let's count off. And I think at the first count, there were 11 or 12 people.
Rescuers now know that some victims have survived beneath the rubble, but getting them out in time to save their lives will require heavy equipment and a lot of luck. 81, Kansas City, 11:05 p.m. 4 hours have passed since two skywalks crushed hundreds of partygoers at the Kansas City Hyatt. 11-year-old Dalton Grant and his mother, Connie, are buried alive near the center of the fallen skywalk, along with several others. As jackhammers pound away at the concrete overhead, the 11-year-old tries desperately to get someone's attention.
I mean, I was screaming. I was belting some good ones out. This firefighter heard me screaming. He went down into the rubble as close as he could to talk to me, and he would tell me everything they were doing.
I saw a firefighter laying on his stomach in the water glass, and he was talking. And I said, "What are you doing?" Joe, he said, "There's a kid under here."
Outside the Hyatt, rescue personnel tell reporters how they intend to extricate the survivors from the twisted steel and concrete.
Chief, behind us are a number of cranes and bulldozers and forklifts. What are they attempting to do right now?
We're trying to remove those catwalks to get to the injured and dead people that are under those walks.
Inside the lobby, buried under the center of the downed skywalks, real estate appraiser Tom Weir, his wife Jean, and a few others have confirmed their positions with rescuers by counting off through a hole in the debris. But their numbers have dwindled since they began an hour ago.
I think we did it three times, and I think it was 11 or 12 the first time, and then maybe 7 the second time.
Outside, Fire Department Deputy Chief Arnett Williams knows the survivors are running out of time. He orders construction cranes to smash through the four-story wall of glass.
The initial smash of those things hitting the front of the building, and then the glass, I remember, just sounded like rain.
With the cranes positioned directly above the skywalks, rescuers begin to attach cables to the concrete. Structural engineer Jack Gillum and several officials from Crown Redevelopment, the company that oversaw construction of the Hyatt, arrive and survey the wreckage. Gillum quickly identifies a deadly flaw in the construction. The points where the suspension rods connect to the skywalks are missing steel support plates, called stiffeners.
I said, "Where are the stiffeners?" Stiffeners would have carried the load and would have prevented the collapse. And I was engineer of record of the Hyatt at that point in time, too. It's sort of your worst nightmare, and it has come to life.
At St. Mary's Hospital, radio newsman Chuck Hayes has just come out of surgery for 6 compression fractures in his back and his crushed legs.
First thing I remember, I woke up and I saw my mother. I knew I hadn't died at that point. So I breathed a sigh of relief. My next question was, where was Jane? Was Jane okay?
His wife, Jane, is in critical condition. When she was hit by the falling concrete, her torso was compressed, forcing her ribs down onto her hips, what doctors call a total body collapse. Surgeons fight to save her life on the operating table. 5.5 hours after the collapse, the death toll is over 60. But rescuers maintain hope that they can save the few remaining survivors.
Harold, was I correct when I said that you had been in contact with 4 or 5 people?
All right, our last count is that we are now in contact with 7 people. One youngster that is 11 years old, he seems to be in pretty good shape. We've had a firefighter talking to him for the past hour.
Near what used to be the main bar, firefighters work feverishly, digging down inch by inch to get closer to Dalton Grant and his mother, Connie. But while rescuers focus their attention on the center of the lobby, they don't know that at the far north end, Mark Williams is struggling to hold on. The little girl he had been praying with died over an hour ago.
She was very coherent and very sweet, intelligent little girl. I wish I'd had a chance to meet her.
Both of his legs are severely dislocated, his feet pinned behind his ears.
I remember reaching up here on my left ankle and rubbing it, trying to get the circulation going back in. I'm thinking to myself, they're probably going to amputate that leg. You're going to have to figure out how you're going to go duck hunting with one leg. So it's kind of embarrassing. I'm not thinking about my family. I'm thinking about myself to go duck hunting.
The cranes begin hoisting the huge sections of the fourth floor skywalk an inch at a time.
Some of the people down there thought we weren't moving fast enough. I think one of the concerns was hurry, hurry, hurry. But it wasn't something you could hurry with. If you go into helter-skelter, then you're going to have a worse problem than you've got already.
7 hours after the collapse, rescuers move a section of the concrete that is covering 11-year-old Dalton Grant. And for the first time, he believes he has a chance to survive.
The light broke through from the hole and that fresh air that was just, I mean, talk about breath of life.
When they did get him out, I mean, a huge roar of applause and cheers went up. All the firefighters and the emergency workers that were there and the construction workers, they just felt so relieved.
Dalton's mother, Connie, is also pulled from the rubble with two broken ankles. The two are rushed to a waiting ambulance. Just a few yards away, paramedic Mark Graven and Dr. Joe Wackerly squeeze through a hole to reach Tom and Jean Weir. It is no easy task.
Below the concrete is a metal roof. It was a long rescue, and we cleaned the hole out and found out that there was three in this pocket.
Suddenly, you could see light. And boy, I never appreciated light more than I did at that time.
They were really intertwined, if you will, with some victims that hadn't survived, and we had to take some drastic measures to get them out.
Wackerly must remove the limbs of the dead to allow Graven to first pull Tom, then Jean Weir, to safety. His left leg shattered, the rescue was a painful one for Tom.
I remember someone pulling me by my leg and then pulling me by both legs, and I thought, boy, I wish you wouldn't pull me by that leg.
The Weirs are rushed to separate hospitals. Eight and a half hours after the collapse, rescue workers have shifted their focus to recovering the deceased. But there is one more survivor. At the north end of the skywalks, Mark Williams lies barely conscious under tons of concrete. As the rescuers check the north end one last time, Williams hears shouting above him.
I heard the voice, and I yelled back, hey, I'm underneath here. And they heard me, and then I remember that voice saying, my God, there's somebody alive.
Joe Wackerly is told the good news, but the doctor, who has saved dozens of people over the past 7 hours, is too exhausted to make the last rescue.
I was done, and there was one more to go, and I had a trauma surgeon who had been on standby, and I said, would you please do the last one? I can't do anymore. The irony of this is I didn't know who it was, and Mark and I were friends in high school and ran track together.
An hour later, a volunteer's jackhammer finally cuts its way through the rubble to Mark. But the rescue itself nearly kills him.
The first time they ran the jackhammer in, it came under my arm and between my ribs. And the next time they ran the jackhammer through, it came between my legs. And so now I'm thinking to myself, the next one's going to come right through my back. And I'm yelling and screaming now and saying, don't run that jackhammer in here again.
Williams is the final victim pulled alive from the debris. As the last section of skywalk is lifted, firefighters make a grisly discovery, 31 more victims. This pushes the death toll to 111, with over 200 injured, many of them severely. The ordeal now over, rescuers return to their homes in a state of shock.
I mean, there was so much in my head, and I was tired, but I wasn't tired, and I didn't want to talk about it, and I wanted to be left alone.
I remember being so exhausted when I came home that morning to my wife, and so tired that you want to cry.
July 18th, 1981, Kansas City, 8:05 a.m. It is 13 hours after two massive skywalks collapsed at the Hyatt Regency Hotel. The death toll will reach 114, with over 200 injured. A few blocks away, at Truman Medical Center, Mark Williams, the last person removed alive from the rubble, lies in his hospital bed with severe trauma to his kidneys.
I remember my mother saying, doctor, is he gonna live? And the doctor said, I don't know, I don't think so. Supposedly, I sat up on the table and said, like hell, I'm not going to live. I'm going to be hunting ducks on October 17th. Then I laid back down and went to sleep.
In a room down the hall, Tom Weir is suffering from a fractured leg and severe kidney damage. but his thoughts are with his wife, Jean, who was taken to another hospital across town. Then, he gets an unexpected visit.
Two police officers came into my room and said, "Don't worry, Jean's okay." And at that point, that's when I knew that everything was going to be all right.
Radio news reporter Chuck Hayes is recovering after emergency surgery on his back and shattered legs.
There was a possibility that I would not have use of my right leg. The very real possibility of amputation was there. And I begged them not to take my leg. And I prayed that I would not lose my leg.
His wife, Jane, has survived emergency surgery and is in critical condition. Because of severe damage to her internal organs, doctors list her prognosis as day-to-day. A day and a half after the collapse, the Hyatt Regency is the site of an enormous cleanup and many unanswered questions. KNBC TV reporter Michael Mahoney, who broke the story, follows the investigation.
The search for why those skywalks crashed Friday night proceeded on several fronts. Investigators, including some hired privately by the management and the ownership of the hotel, pored over the rubble. And in the meantime, the Kansas City chapter of the American Architects Institute refused to speculate on what happened, but did defend the skywalk's construction. Michael Mahoney reporting the news, City Hall.
In order to get an objective analysis of the tragedy, Mayor Richard Berkeley puts the investigation in the hands of the National Bureau of Standards, a federal agency. Edward Frang, chief of the National Bureau's Structures Division, heads the inquiry.
We will not be making any comments concerning the results of our investigation until it has been concluded.
We arrived the very day following the request from Mayor Berkeley. Our job was simply to find the most probable cause of collapse.
With the investigation underway, Mayor Berkeley turns his attention to the victims who survived the ordeal and praises the rescue effort.
Certainly the patients that I visited yesterday could not be more thankful or more appreciative or give more recognition to what was done for them, without exception.
The coordination between the police and the fire and the medical staff was excellent.
Reporters flocked to hospitals all over Kansas City to hear the survivors' firsthand accounts. Jean Weir is recuperating at St. Mary's Hospital.
I couldn't see 2 inches in front of my face. All I could hear were moanings and screaming.
11-year-old Dalton Grant and his mother, Connie, convalesce on different floors.
I was in the dark so long. When I looked up at all the white and strange faces, like every new face I see, it's not like it's real.
I was in pelvic traction. I'm hanging from a sling. I just wanted to get the hell out of there, you know, just get out of the hospital and get back to my house.
At Baptist Medical Center, Dr. Joe Wackerly is being hailed as a hero, though he wrestles with his conscience.
I had to dismember some bodies to get some other bodies, to get some live people out, and I had to let a few people die in order that others might live, who were going to die no matter what I did.
You live with that decision the rest of your life, and you wonder, could I have done more? Did I assess this patient right? I had this incredible guilt that I was becoming a quasi-hero celebrity based on terrible events that happened to other people, and I didn't want that to happen. I did my job.
7 months after the disaster, Edward Frang, chief of the Structures Division of the National Bureau of Standards, concludes the report. He finds that the collapse occurred exactly as engineer Jack Gillum suspected. The connections keeping the skywalk suspended, the box beam hanger rod connections, were poorly constructed.
All of the box beam hanger rod connections were never adequate to even come close to the requirements of the then existing Kansas City building code.
The reason for the catastrophe was one small but fatal decision. Early on in the construction, Jack Gillum's firm got a request from the steel fabricator to approve a change in the design of the hanger rod supports.
Originally, the design called for a single hanger rod that went from the second floor walkway right on up through that walkway, through the fourth floor walkway, and straight up through the ceiling. It just wasn't a practical thing.
Instead of continuous hanger rods, the steel fabricator wanted to offset them. Gillum's engineering firm okayed the change. It simply meant that prior to delivery to the construction team, steel plates, called stiffeners, would need to be inserted by the fabricator into the box beam to bear the brunt of the load. Gillum and his associates assumed the fabricators would know to build the stiffeners, but they didn't. The result, the deadliest structural engineering failure in U.S. history.
The box beam was coming down, down, down over the nut and washer, and eventually just split open, ripped through, and the whole thing came down on the atrium floor below.
After 7.5 years of litigation, the state of Missouri holds Gillum's engineering firm responsible for the Hyatt disaster and revokes his license to practice in that state.
As an engineer of record, you take the full responsibility, and that's what I did. I sealed the drawing, and that's what, where the buck stopped, and that's where it will on every single project.
The Hyatt Corporation and the Hallmark Corporation, whose subsidiary, Crown Center Redevelopment, oversaw construction of the hotel, would also be held responsible. They would eventually pay out over $70 million in settlements.
What is a human life worth? 114 people lost their lives. I would say they got off damn cheap.
I was angry after what I read, what I saw. There were no systems of checks and balances. That is unforgivable.
Today, most of the victims of the disaster are happy to put the ordeal behind them. Tom and Jean Weir still live in Kansas City. They now have 2 kids.
We hold no animosity, no bitterness towards any of those folks. Their lives were shattered too. They live day in and day out with the understanding that because of a mistake, terrible things happened. And I feel for them. It was a mistake. That's all it was.
Mark Williams is married with 3 kids and still enjoys hunting.
We made the opening day of duck season, just like I said I would. Running into people from the Hyatt now, typically we don't talk about injuries, we don't talk about the Hyatt, that's behind us.
Chuck and Jane Hayes both made full recoveries.
My one goal was to be able to walk into a room and not have people stare at me. A lot of physical therapy, a lot of work. But today I can do almost anything, except shoot a good game of golf.
Dalton Grant, now 31, and his mother, Connie, have no lingering injuries. But the memory of the Hyatt disaster still haunts him.
A couple years ago, they were doing construction at one of the malls. And you know, one of the floors was ripped up and through the side, which looked a lot like the debris and stuff. That kind of stuff kind of gets to me.
After receiving numerous citations for supervising the triage effort, Dr. Joe Wackerly now lectures on disaster response and acts as a consultant to the government and the National Football League.
What I'm most proud of is the community of Kansas City. The external reviews and the after-action reports that evaluated what we did were very positive. And that's why it became sort of a classic disaster response to study, so that the lessons learned could be applied to other disasters in the future.